King Ragnar. That is my name. King Ragnar.
Cold is the ocean spring. And your death is on its way.
Even if I am not a king, I am an earl. I must return to look after my people.
Hello, and welcome to the review for the ASUS PG27VQ. So before we start, I want to clarify a very important information. The PG27VQ, which is reviewed in this video, is a TN monitor without quantum dots, whereas the PG27VQR, which isn't released yet, is the version with quantum dots. The PG27VQR, of course, also will be reviewed on this channel as soon as it's released. Packaged with this monitor is a DisplayPort cable, a HDMI cable, a USB 3.0 cable, a power cable, individual customizable covers for the light and motion footstand lighting, a short guide, and a support CD with some extras like the ASUS Sync software. For connections, it has a DisplayPort 1.2 input, a HDMI 1.4 input, 2x USB 3.0 downstream, and a headphone jack. You can hide all inputs with the included covering plate from ASUS. With regards to the processing, the build quality feels very sturdy, leaving a very good impression of the overall build quality. It has a frameless panel design with bezels which are 8mm thick on the left, top and right. On the bottom, bezels are 2.1 cm thick. The PG27VQ don't have built-in speakers, but you can control the volume for the headphone jack within the OSD menu. On the back, ASUS includes a new RGB lighting, which is called Aura Sync. Through the OSD, you can set rainbow and color cycle, as well as static, breathing, and strobing within red, green, blue, cyan, magenta, and yellow. ASUS is advertising even more lighting modes, which probably can only be used within the software. The software on the support CD, by the way, does not work on my PC, probably because of its bug. I've tested to run the Aura Sync software on two PCs and on my laptop with Windows 8. Unfortunately, it does not work. So, how about the curve? It's got a radius of 1800 and is a nice but not a must-have feature. The difference, at least for me, is only very slight. Why a curve is not the optimum for an edge LED solution, I will tell you in the topic black level and backlight uniformity. The footstand is already known from other ASUS models like the PG348Q or the PG258Q. It's made out of metal and feels very sturdy and well built. The stand was also designed with cable management in mind and offers an average and simple solution. As a small gimmick, you can enable the light in motion, which simply projects the RockSwift logo onto your desk surface. And so ASUS includes three blank covers with which you can customize your own projection. Within the OSD menu, you can turn it off or switch between three different brightness settings. No RGB and only in red. The minimum range from the display to the wall is around 28.5 cm at the sides and 26 cm in the middle of the screen while it's a curved design. Height adjustment ranges from 5.5 to 15.5 cm. You also can swivel and tilt. No pivot for this monitor. A very good and solid footstand. The design, of course, is personal taste. So, let's take a closer look into navigation. Next to a 4-way joystick behind the right side of the monitor, we find 4 more physical buttons. Power on off, the game visual hotkey with all presets, quick menu overview, the game plus menu, which is the same as on the PG27-8QR with a new refresh rate indicator, and a close menu button. By clicking on the joypad, we come into the main menu. The first option is to enable the overdrive feature to overclock the monitor to 165Hz. Next to a blue light filter, which can be disabled and changed within 4 different levels. At color, we change the brightness, contrast, the color temperature between normal, warm, cool, and user mode. At gamma, we can change between gamma 1.8, 2.2, and 2.4. At image, we can choose between 2 different overdrive settings and off. Enable the adaptive contrast control and enable dark boost, which is a black equalizer. At last, we can turn on light and motion, sync the monitor's RGB lighting with other Asus sync software, and enable Aura RGB with already mentioned different modes. First, I was very skeptical about creating a TN panel with a 1800R curve design because of backlight bleed and clouding issues. The result, however, is very acceptable. I would say around 5 to 6 points out of 10, whereas the PG27-8Q has a score of around 6 to 7 points out of 10 in my opinion. Still, I can see a bit of clouding and 2 backlight bleed spots on the top frame. On the lower right, also a bit more noticeable and brighter blacks compared to the PG27-8QR. Keep in mind that the black level of course depends on your brightness settings. So the uniformity subjectively on my unit is okay, but still worse compared to the PG27-8QR. While the PG27-8QR is worse than current full HD 144Hz models like the ViewSonic XG2401 for example. Consider, individual units also can differentiate in clouding, backlight bleed, etc. On 136 candela, I had a black point of 0.15 candela, which is an average result compared to current Quad HD TN panels. The PG27-8QR here also is a bit better. According to the curve, I think in general it's a nice feature, but personally I would prefer a flat screen because of fewer issues with the homogeneity, clouding, and of course backlight bleed. These both measurings are measured at 133 candela and optimum settings with a white point of 6500K, a deviation of maximum 12% in the backlight uniformity and a deviation of maximum 1.5 in the white point homogeneity. The homogeneity in person also seems pretty good. Only close to the right and left I can notice a bit shift in color temperature and brightness. As already mentioned, the PG27VQ don't has a quantum dot panel. The PG27VQR with a quantum dot panel will be released later this year and also reviewed on this channel. So, the Asus has a color gamut coverage of 96.6% sRGB and 71.2% Adobe RGB, and a color gamut volume of 111.4% sRGB and 76.8% Adobe RGB. The impression straight out of the box otherwise already is very good for a TN panel. Subjectively, I would say there is no difference to the PG27-8QR. Measured gamma on the PG27VQ is 1.9 on 1.8, 2.3 on 2.2 and 2.7 on 2.4, so that we don't hit the perfect gamma 2.2 value without calibrating the monitor or make some changes within the graphics card software. Still, 2.3 is not bad at all. For the color temperature, the Asus has a native color temperature of 5860K. For the viewing angles, they are just TN typical. It's nothing special, while you still will have the usual gamma shift. According to a grayscale test, the Asus is not bad and also not very good. Something in between. It has a little bit of yellowish, greenish, bluish tint in darker gray states, which is usual for a TN panel type monitor. The only one problem is that the Asus loses a bit more details in the last 4 gray steps in form of a tiny bit black crush, where you cannot differentiate these four gray steps from each other. But nothing really to worry about in my opinion. When taking a closer look into color banding and gradients and darker image content, there is like no difference to the PG27-8QR. Compared to an IPS panel, still it looks worse, as currently all Quad HD 144Hz and above AU Optronics TN panels. The panel coating. Unfortunately, it's the same as on the PG27-8QR and the Acer XB27-1HUA, and for me personally, the biggest downside of this monitor. On bright image content, like for example browsing the web, you will be able to see the panel coating in form of a glitter effect and dirt. It's very hard to explain. Unfortunately, it's also not possible to capture this on camera. If you want more information and examples within the panel coating of the Asus PG27V, please take a look at my PG27-8QR review, where I go more in depth on this topic. So while it's the same, I don't need to repeat and I can keep this review a bit shorter. So let's find out how the Asus handles its response time. In general, the response time is very good on this model. Again, as same as on the PG27-8QR. Here you can see pictures taken from the UFO test. On normal, you will have the best motion blur results, while extreme creates too many artifacts. Very good results on this TN monitor. Within the text scrolling, J-square and Eiffel Tower test, everything seems fine. Only a tiny bit of green color temperature artifacts on its native color temperature. This, however, is not an issue, and nearly all panels will have some color temperature artifacts, mostly on moving text. The Asus here unfortunately has another problem. Pixel inversion in moving objects, mostly visible on uniform mid bright colors. Within the inverse artifacts test from Blurbusters, you can see this issue pretty clearly, even on the photo. In games, it was not possible to capture this on camera, but depending on image content, also sometimes noticeable. This, however, for me personally, is not a huge problem. G-Sync works great, the same as ULMB. Flickering only within a load screen, of course when dropping under the G-Sync range. Still, I found something weird. When watching a YouTube video, for example, in full screen, the monitor automatically switches into G-Sync mode. So if you use ULMB on desktop, it will turn off ULMB when you join a game, for example. Even when you have set your frequency to 120Hz. You can avoid this easily while turning G-Sync off. I've measured the brightness peak on standard settings for the maximum and minimum luminance. These are the results from my measurement. With the Asus you have an average contrast ratio of 909:1 on its native color temperature, which is a good but not very good result. After calibrating to 6500K, the contrast ratio drops to 768:1 on my unit. Consider, the color temperature also is personal preference. So the final question is this monitor worth it, and is it better than the PG27-8QR? I would say it depends. In Germany the current price is 860 €. For this price it's absolutely not worth to buy this monitor. An IPS panel will have of course the better image quality. So how much would I pay for the Asus? Not more than the PG27-8QR. And here I directly can tell you that the PG27VQ isn't a better monitor. Differences are very, very small. The new model does only have one real advantage to the PG27-8QR. And this is the much brighter ULMB aka blacklight scanning feature, at least if you need this. Both monitors are very good and close as same, while the PG27V is a bit weaker in terms of contrast, backlight bleed issues and black uniformity, at least on my unit. According to all other topics I've tested, I would say this simply is personal preference. You like the curve and the RGBs, you prefer the PG27V's design and footstand? Go for it. But in my opinion only as long as it does not cost much more. than the PG27-8QR. Is it worth it to upgrade from the PG27-8QR to the PG27-VQ? Hell no! I'm still very curious about the PG27V with quantum dots and hope that Asus will release the quantum dot version very soon. So, what do you guys think about the PG27-VQ? Is it worth it? Let me know in the commentaries.